Good morning, everybody. I'm Kathryn Carruthers. I'm a freelance webmaster. I have to look at my computer to know that. I've been building websites in general since the web was invented, mostly for labor organizations where I was staff. And for the past couple of years, I've been a freelance webmaster, just working with nonprofits and charities to do their Drupal sites mostly, but almost always CiviCRM, so to do event planning and fundraising and stuff like that. So when I saw a call for speakers this morning, I thought, I can talk about CiviCRM for an hour. So in case you don't know what it is, it's kind of like Salesforce, but for nonprofits and charities and political organizations, for civic-minded organizations. So, and they call it, instead of a client relationship management system, it's a constituent relationship management system. So that's harder to say. But it handles the relationship parts of it differently, even though it does have money can be involved in collecting contributions and donations and event fees and stuff like that. It's less, like instead of having a sales funnel going through your CRM, it's a relationship funnel. So you're looking at the activities that people are doing with your organization. It's also an open source project, similar to Drupal, and everybody knows like how open source works, right? Like that, yeah, okay. CiviCRM works right now very well with Drupal 7, Backdrop, and WordPress, and Joomla. And they're working on, there are a couple of organizations working on making it work well with Drupal 8. It's not released for Drupal 8 yet, but there are, as I'll get to later, a couple of places that are actually implementing Drupal 8 with CiviCRM. The major things it does are dependent on the organization. So I've got a couple of clients who use it mostly to manage their email with their members or the general public, both in like you can have individual emails, group emails, and then bulk email with an SMTP provider. It also has a really nice event planning segment, so you can create various types of events. So you can have conferences, meetings, webinars, all of that, both paid and just sign up. And the event planning part of Civi handles all of that registration, keeps the records in the person's dashboard. And so you can see at a glance the entire scope of your relationship with the person. You can see all the emails they've gotten, whether they've unsubscribed, whether they've come to all of your events, whether they paid for all of your events or signed up for all of your free events and then not shown up, so maybe shouldn't be invited anymore. Like all of that kind of stuff is really easy to access in CiviCRM. It also deals with contributions and donations. So for charitable organizations, it's really useful to be able, for a fundraiser, to be able to get a history of a person's monetary involvement with your organization, so you can target your, you know, top donors and invite them to a special event, or you know, hit them up for more money. Then there's subscriptions and memberships. I've done a lot of work with memberships. So you, like specifically paid memberships, you can have a membership expire and then the all of the content on your website that's member focused, all of a sudden, you know, if you haven't paid your membership, it's just gone with Drupal. It's easy. We'll get into why it's easy to do that in Drupal as opposed to in WordPress or Joomla. It's really harder to set up that kind of role-based access to things. So one of the benefits to having CiviCRM and Drupal is if you have paywalled information, you can really easily lock it down with your Drupal permissions. And then there's case management, which I haven't done, but that's like if you're an organization that has clients where you're managing, say, family for a social work situation or something like that, or like medical and social assistance organizations can use it to manage their clients' cases. Okay, the hosting requirements for CiviCRM are similar to Drupal. Like if you can run Drupal, you can usually run CiviCRM. I usually add on some extra memory, especially if you're going to have a lot of end users using the CiviCRM. So if you've got a lot of people interacting with your CiviCRM as opposed to just your internal staff, you'd want to add on some RAM for the extra sessions. But otherwise, if you can run Drupal, you can usually run, like unless it's very, very low-end hosting that Drupal crawls on, you can run CiviCRM on any hosting. There are recently a few providers who are, like I know of Symbiotic and Praxis in Montreal that do manage Drupal and CiviCRM. So if you don't want to deal with the hosting, like if you're a small organization and you don't have people like us to manage it, you can use a hosted managed CiviCRM. So all you're worrying about is the actual CiviCRM configuration. And then this place, My Drop Wizard, it's in the States, so we get into all kinds of other, you know, issues with having your data stored outside of Canada. But aside from that, My Drop Wizard is doing hosted managed CiviCRM. They're doing CiviCRM as a service, basically. So software as a service with Drupal 8. So they're rolling that out over the next few weeks. And they're actually offering right now a limited number of free migrations. So if you have a client maybe who has CiviCRM on Drupal 7 and they're interested in moving to Drupal 8, if you go to My Drop Wizard like this weekend, you can fill out an application and they're doing a certain number of migrations for free to Drupal 8, migration and upgrade, and then you sign up for their service for, I don't know, 6 months or something, and then you get your migration for free. So if you happen to know of anybody who's strapped that needs a new CiviCRM on a new Drupal, that's an offer that's going to be running up really soon. So, okay, there are two supported versions of CiviCRM, similar to, like, you can have Drupal 7 or Drupal 8. You can be running CiviCRM 4.7, which is kind of the latest and greatest. Every new feature goes into 4.7 point whatever when the new one comes out. Or they've got a long-term support version, which is 4.6. So when some extensions may not be, like we'll get into that later, but CiviCRM has its own extensions library similar to the Drupal contributed modules. So some extensions are written and tested with 4.6 and not 4.7. So if you want to run 4.7, you'd have to do some of your own testing of modules to make sure that they're working. But they're not necessarily supported by the extension writers. So on the newest version. Okay. Once you've figured out what version you're running and what you're running it on, then getting into CiviCRM itself, out of the box, it's got three different contact types. So you've got individuals, organizations, and households. And then you'll create your own types of organizations. You can create an entire contact type, but that's really complicated, and I'm assuming most people don't want to do that. So you would create a subtype that uses all the contact type, but just groups your types of organizations. So that's, in my experience, it's usually either chapters or regions or member organizations of a larger organization that would be subtypes, so that then you can create relationships between people and their organizations. So I've put a few of the organizations, because as in life, you could have an individual who's, like Mike, is employed by Open Concept. He could also be a member of the Ottawa Drupal Association and a member of a household with his partner and children who get mail delivered to them. So when you're doing mail, the only thing households is really used for in most charities is to ensure you're not sending like five pieces of mail to the same house because you've got multiple people there. So you'll, with one click, you can say only produce one mailing label per household. And so you join the people into the households, and similar for organizations, because often, especially for charities, you'll have individual donors and members and things like that, but you also may have organizations that do not necessarily have individuals attached to them on your mailing list. Like you'd send letters to local businesses dealing with Drupal, you'd send a letter to, if you don't know Mike, you'd send a letter to Open Concept as an organization. Okay. So it's clearer once you get into it. And if anybody has any questions, feel free to, you know, stop me, because otherwise I'm going to run out of talking soon.
I missed the first couple minutes. Is it still intended to be able to be run as standalone?
No. They don't have a standalone. Very, very few people or organizations were using the standalone.
Yeah.
And the purpose of the standalone was really if you didn't have a website. So who's using a CRM that doesn't have a website? So if you really don't want to deal with having a real website, you can always just have an empty copy of Drupal or WordPress or whatever, like depending on the extensions and modules you want to use.
So when
you just pick your CRM and bring that up and just don't populate the website.
So back in the day when it was intended to be able to be run as a standalone, I know that there's a lot of redundancy in what Civi offered and what Drupal did, so you use
And they've really, when we go and look at the extensions and modules, they've really streamlined the list of modules in Drupal that duplicate things that were in CiviCRM. So when you go to the extensions list, you see everything that's relevant for your installation. So if you're running 4.6 on, I think we're going to get to that in just a few minutes, but because I have a whole slide about extensions and modules. So one of the things almost everybody uses is some form of bulk messaging. So there are many ways to set that up. You can, if you're very daring, just use the built-in server mail processing and blast out thousands of emails and then deal with all the bounces and responses or not, and just have them go into a can and really annoy people because they keep getting emails because the bounces aren't being processed properly on the back end. Or you can set up a proper mail service to handle bounces, and like if you're comfortable with handling a mail service as a manager. One messaging system it does not play nicely with is Exchange and Office 365. They just, 365 just drops everything coming because it doesn't understand industry, like internet standard SMTP headers and stuff like that, because it expects to talk through its own gateways all the time. So,
and Google is even worse at that.
I've never done Google. I find that when I've tried to use Gmail as my SMTP outgoing, it does a lot of throttling that it's not telling you about. So you'll think you've, like CiviCRM will report that, yes, I've sent out your 1,000 email messages, but actually Google just drops a lot of them. So without telling you. So like they don't come back as bounced or throttled or anything. They just don't actually go anywhere past Google. Unlike, it may be different if you've got like a corporate Google that you're all like, no? Oh, okay. I've never tried it because I had horrible issues with it. There are, there's CiviSMTP.org is a little company that is set up specifically, like all they do is manage SMTP servers for CiviCRM. So the absolute easiest way to set up outgoing bulk mail with CiviCRM is to open an account with CiviSMTP and pay them their $20 a month or whatever. And it does escalate in price if you really get into bulk mailing and you're sending out a lot of stuff. Like I have one client who sends out 100,000 messages in a month regularly. So for them, it would cost a lot more than the hosting to support their mail through CiviSMTP. So they're using a service called SparkPost that is free for your first 40,000, I think, and then very reasonably priced for bulk mailing over that. So I think they're going to end up spending like $25 a month on a big month to do all of their mailing. So I like SparkPost. And it also, the people at SparkPost have like their own APIs and everything, and they make it really easy to hook into them. And they've written an extension for CiviCRM. So all you have to do is get like an API key and plug it into your CiviCRM and say, yes, send all my mail through SparkPost. So, yay. But like I said, there are other options for doing email, but that's kind of, if you want to keep it simple.
MailChimp?
There used to be an extension, but I'm not sure. Like I've never used it because, again, of the pricing. MailChimp, once you get into bigger mailings, gets more expensive. So, and the things you're paying for with a service like SparkPost has its own MailChimp-like features, but the things you're really paying for with those services is all of the analytics and bounce handling and all of that. And those are all handled through CiviCRM, so you're not really using that as much. Like you need your bounce channel set up to come back to you, but from like what I've done, I find SparkPost is the easiest and cheapest to get going. And we are, you know, when you're talking about charities and nonprofits, they tend, you know, money is very, yeah.
So things like SparkPost and CRM, like an email discussion group, right, or like somebody joins an organization or adds to a list that anyone can email to, and everybody gets it, they can opt out if they want.
Or
can only, you know, blast email from a central organization.
I haven't done, no, I think you'd have to, you could manage the membership in the list through CiviCRM, but it doesn't have like a chat function built in. I wouldn't be surprised if they're working on that, because later in the resources, I've got a link to, they're using Mattermost for their like developer and support chats now, so I wouldn't be surprised if they try to integrate Mattermost into CiviCRM at some point.
That's like a mailman, like the mailman newsletters tool.
Yeah, like all of the unsubscribes and stuff like that are handled in CiviCRM, but...
Okay. But like, could you synchronize the mailman list with a list in CiviCRM?
Yeah, I mean, you can certainly import, you could do your list management through CiviCRM, at worst by doing import-exports, but yeah, because I was thinking the actual chat functionality it isn't there, but it's a really interesting thing to look into, yeah. Okay, one of the things I've loved about Civi over the last few years is, and especially with Drupal, is that you can set up all of your email lists to be confirmed. So all users have to confirm that they've agreed to be on this list to comply with the Canadian anti-spam legislation. And the opt-outs and unsubscribes are all handled like right in CiviCRM, so you're not accidentally sending out government considered spam. And it's just out of the box, actually, the unsubscribe messages and the opt-out messages are like, it's not just a line that pops up saying, okay, you're out. So because generally you want to keep people in, so you can add your own messaging around these screens, but the out-of-the-box screen confirm, like it says, please confirm your unsubscribe, so you have a chance there to do a little user retention if you want to, and they have to verify their email to unsubscribe. Yeah?
You know, does it support a lot where where they would basically send out an email saying, you know, bad, it's listening, and they want to be subscribed?
Yes. I haven't set that up because, again, I'm working with people who, like everybody coming in, is signing up through the website, so we give them the option to opt out or unsubscribe in every message. So we haven't made them go back and forth. But you can have that in your Drupal setup. Like if you're signing people up through a Drupal site, then yeah, you can use the Drupal opt-in, like set up your user accounts in Drupal that way. So it really depends on the front end you're putting it in front of it. Like in WordPress, you'd have to add a couple of extensions to do that, or whatever, what are the WordPress called there? Plugins. Yeah, you'd have to add plugins to WordPress to do that, whereas it's just in your user configuration in Drupal, so. Okay, this is the big blah on the screen. It is the first couple of paragraphs from the link at the bottom in the very long page about CMS permissions and CiviCRM ACLs, because you have both. So you can choose to configure very granular access within CiviCRM. So if you've got, like recently I had an event manager who it has no other responsibilities in CiviCRM. She's just running an event for a chapter of an organization that I'm working for the national head office. And we were able to, in CiviCRM, let her just come in and see who signed up for her event every day. Instead of having to run a report and send it to her, she can just log in anytime she wants and see the event list. So you can do that very fine-grained control in CiviCRM itself, but you have, and again, this is, it's not showing up at all. Okay, this is a screen capture of all of the default CiviCRM permissions, and it actually isn't showing up on the screen because it goes on for, you know, pages and pages that you can set. In Drupal, you define roles of, site administrators, event coordinators, membership managers, whatever, you know, the functional roles you have in your organization. You set those up as roles in your Drupal, and then you can give overriding permissions to each person to see exactly what they're supposed to. So because they're Drupal permissions, they work exactly like Drupal permissions. So when you go into CiviCRM, if you have no permissions to see or interact with events, you do not see the events menu at all. You just get each user just gets the things you've defined in Drupal permissions. Okay. Then there's extensions. So similar to, there are Drupal modules that affect CiviCRM only on Drupal. And then there's a CiviCRM extensions library. So if in your CiviCRM, if you go to administer extensions, you will see a list of, and then click on add new, you'll see a list of all of the extensions that are relevant for your implementation. So it looks at your Drupal version, your CiviCRM version. I think you can probably filter it down further, but the default list is just everything that will work for you that's tested for your version. You can still go out, just like in Drupal, and find a sandbox extension that's not certified for use on yours and install it, but through the point and click method, it will only show you things that will work. So most people like that. Dave doesn't.
No, I'm really curious. I wanted to hear like what kind of sacrifice you had to make to the dark gods to make an extension that worked on WordPress, Drupal 7, Drupal 8, Drupal.
That's
is there like
There are some, yeah, there are some that are, one that works on every version of CiviCRM 4.6, so it's been tested on WordPress and Joomla and Drupal, because it's just in CiviCRM is the Civi discount, so, and it's one of the most popular, so if you're running events, you can say, okay, if you're a member already, you get in free. If you're this role, you get a 50% discount. If it's an early bird, you get this discount code. Like, so you make up coupon codes, basically, that people can enter and get the right amount of money. So that is anything that's specifically in CiviCRM alone and doesn't depend on the functionality of the content management system will show up for everybody.
Okay, so CiviCRM does like expose its own API to extensions.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay, and then those extensions can generally work on every CiviCRM.
They'll work on all of the different CiviCRMs and and similar to like in Drupal, you'll have in Drupal you don't have things that work automatically from one version to the next ever, but it'll show you in a module which versions are available. So CiviCRM extensions are like that. There are also a number of Drupal modules that only, like they're stored over on Drupal.org, just like all other modules. But they only interact with Drupal sites, so while they are accessible from civicrm.org, they're only listed for Drupal sites. So the main ones, like the most fun ones that you almost always install are WebForm CiviCRM integration. And I just recently did a CiviCRM migration from Joomla to Drupal. And when they saw WebForms, they were just like, oh my God, it's WebForms just blew their mind. So what the WebForm CiviCRM integration module does is it exposes CiviCRM fields to be used in a web form. So instead of just making up new fields that say first name, last name, organization, blah, 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 like all of the things you're already storing in CiviCRM, you just pop those fields in there, the CiviCRM fields, as tokens, and then when somebody fills out your form, that information, and can we send you email? That information immediately goes into CiviCRM. So, because that's the database that's exposed on the web form. So, same with contact form integration. It has, I think, as notes, any web, like anything you're doing on Drupal contact forms can be stored in CiviCRM, and then it will show up in dashboards as things to be acted upon by the staff. So that's pretty cool. And then there are Commerce and Uber card integrators that take basically the CiviCRM contributions pieces and use the Drupal Commerce or Uber card on Drupal payment channel to get the money and then just record it in CiviCRM as contributions. So you can also set up, if all of your money stuff is set up in CiviCRM, like if all you're doing is donations or event fees, and you're not also doing commerce activities on your website, you can set up a direct payment processor in CiviCRM, so like PayPal or IATS. And again, IATS has done a lot more work to make their payment processor work well in CiviCRM, and because they're a payment processor for, or a credit card processor for nonprofits. So they like CiviCRM, so CiviCRM likes them. But you can also use more commercial. Yeah?
Do you know if anyone's working on Shopify integrations?
I don't know. I imagine they are. But again, with that, you would probably hook up Shopify to Commerce, right? And then, like, using Shopify as... All I've done so far is, like, embed Shopify sales things in a Drupal site as standalone things that were running through Shopify, so I haven't done that, and I haven't seen it published yet, but somebody is probably working on that. Yeah. Okay. Resources. There's on CiviCRM.org, there are two, here, I'm just going to, can I go there? There are two big books. One that is the user guide. Oh, three big books. They've split the bigger one into developers and administrators. So there's a user guide, a developer guide that talks about the API and all that and how to make your own extensions. And then the administrator guide for people like me who are, you know, site builders and people who just want to read a lot and click and not write code. So, because it's possible. Something I was asked earlier is, why would you not use Red Hen or the Drupal, CRM core? And it's mostly because when it comes down to it, if you're a nonprofit or a charity, you want to be taking in donations and not spending a lot of money on developing a CRM, even though it might be more integrated into your Drupal using CRM core. You want event planning and bulk emails and all of those things very inexpensively. So CiviCRM is just easier for that audience of people and for site builders to go through. And also on the main resources page, it's got a list of, I believe these may be promoted extensions, because the extension library itself is quite large, so you can search through and find it. They have a slightly different relationship with money over at CiviCRM, so they'll do make it happen campaigns. So if there's something that all of the users want, but nobody has the resources to actually code it from the ground up, they'll start a make it happen campaign and pay a developer or a group of developers out of that to actually do the work. So they tend to be for large things. So similar to what Drupal did that with the when D8 was almost ready but not quite, and they needed that final push to just hire some people, to be able to hire some people to actually write and test the code. They did, they took contributions towards that. So CiviCRM does a similar thing, because there are a couple of companies that are focused on developing it for as paid developers, but for the most part, it's just, people who need a certain thing written, so they write it themselves, and then it goes through testing and is integrated. So that's the resources on civicrm.org itself. They've been, for the last year or so, using Mattermost to do, it's kind of like Slack, but open source, to do chats about, they're doing a lot of support through Mattermost, and then it's public, it's out there and searchable and easy to find. They also have a channel on, where you ask questions.
And get Stack Overflow.
Yeah, Stack Overflow. Yeah. Okay. Next month, there's going to be a Civi Camp in Montreal. So anybody super interested in CiviCRM, I have no idea how big it's going to be. I take it it's going to be tiny. There are a couple of really good, one of the core team members is now in Montreal, and so he's one of the drivers behind this camp. And there are a few other organizations that, like Praxis and Symbiotic and Kumbit, that are working on bringing some of the people in the CiviCRM community. So there's one day of sessions and then 2 days of sprinting, 2 or 3 days of sprinting after in Montreal. Okay, and now I'm at the end of my slides, and at the time when I was going to say, does anybody have any more questions? I've got a couple of sites I can show people for examples of things, if there's a specific, for usability, when I was previously working for a union, and our staff there were all researchers and communicators and people like that. They were not technical in any way. and they were able to, you know, manage campaigns and do, you know, their monthly emails or email blasts and all of that with very little intervention. So it's the interface of setting it up is a little intimidating. Like when you first come to a CiviCRM site, well, actually when you set it up, there is a page called the configuration checklist. So basically to create a new CiviCRM, you just go through this, and when everything's changed color, you know, you hit all of the pages you have to type something on. This does not, unfortunately, tell you if you did it right. Like, you have to try sending out your email and make sure you actually go somewhere and stuff like that. But this does tell you you have at least looked at all of the different configuration areas. Because then once you're up and running, then you have this administration console, and it's got like all of the different places where you can create all of your data types, manage your templates and scheduling messages. You can do CiviCRM and multilingual.
Yes.
General question about I don't know, the velocity of development, the uptake. How's it doing? Like, I remember back in the day, it was like a really big trend, something I don't hear as much about anymore.
I think the kind of the guy that spearheaded the project has kind of stepped back, and so now it's more, there's a core group. So like, it's kind of like if Dries retired from doing Drupal, then you'd have, you know, you're still, all of the businesses doing Drupal and all of the people writing the code would still exist, but they've been trying to establish more of that kind of team mentality around approving updates and stuff. But they're still doing, like there are new features monthly and new releases. Like 4.7 is on, I think, 0.31, and it's 3 years old. So it's, you know.
Any idea?
Is that
about
what you meant?
Yeah, sure. And I think the guy in front of Green. Anyway, when
Greenberg.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like, I think he was helping channel some funding from various sources towards CiviCRM. Is there one primary source of funding right now?
No. It's there are a couple of larger institutions that have bought into it. Mostly, it's become quite popular with political parties, so they're a good source of funding because you're not taking, they're trying not to take funding from charities because that goes into the bottom line of the charity. Like, nobody wants to send money to a charity that's spending too much of a percentage managing their systems. So it's kind of a, like, you want them to have good systems, but you don't want them to spend money on it, because it's your hard-earned money and you want it going to whatever the charitable thing is. So they've hit on a lot of political parties, labor organizations, other, you know, kind of social action organizations, but that maybe can spare a bit more money and development time to build the program. So one of the most recent things that went in, I don't have an installation of it to show you, but there's a piece called Civi Campaign. So it's for political parties when you're doing like walk lists or call lists. So you can go, okay, I have 25 volunteers who need to cover a riding in a walk list. You can print them out, a walk list, or put it on their iPads and they go, okay, Susie at number 35 said, yes, she'll vote for us, and don't go there because they'll stick their dogs on you and stuff like that. So they have gotten that done. But as with any other open source project, there's no, like there are a couple of companies that contribute a lot back, but they're not, like there's no kind of paid for funding source. Yeah.
Are you aware of any equal secondaries that are using?
Sorry?
Are you aware of any equal secondaries that are using CIVs?
I know there is a lot of discussion of, like in the access control list, there's a function so that you can share things with somebody who's in a role that's kind of above you, so that students can share homework, say, like upload their homework to their dashboard and share it with their teachers, but they can't see any of the teacher's stuff. So there are those relationships developed if you need them. But I'm not.
There are like colleges, other colleges and universities that are using this in some way.
There must be, because somebody wrote the stuff yeah. in the ACLs for that, like using that use case. Like I've seen use cases for it, not actual names of institutions. Anything else? Okay.